This is CBC Saturday News.
Good evening. I'm Marivel Tarouk. A big crowd of Premier Doug Ford supporters are enjoying the sunshine in Markham today. Ford Fest is underway. The Ford family hosts the celebration event every year, but this one comes after a tumultuous week in Ontario politics. Our Mike Crawley is at Ford Fest for us this evening. So, Mike, it's been quite the week for the Premier.
Yeah, Marivel, you called it tumultuous. I would argue that this has been the worst week for Premier Doug Ford since he won the election last June. It started on Monday at the Raptors victory celebration, where he was mercilessly booed by the large and very diverse and young crowd that was there. Later in the week, on Thursday, he shuffled his cabinet, and the biggest move in that, it was a very, very big cabinet shuffle. He demoted his finance minister, Vic Fedeli, and insisted that this was, you know, not a change in direction for his government, but just simply a reset. So then after that, yesterday was not a good day either. He had to rescind a couple of appointments that were made to these cushy jobs in London and New York, a couple of people who had connections to his chief of staff, Dean French. And then last evening, after 7 o'clock, Dean French, the Premier's most senior political aide, quit. They put out a press release saying that this was the plan all along, but I don't believe for a moment, actually, that Dean French was planning on quitting the night before Ford Fest. So now here we are at Ford Fest, and this is an opportunity for Premier Doug Ford to come to a crowd that he knows is not going to boo him and to be around people that very much support him. Marivel?
And yes, I mean, despite that almost daily bad news for the Premier and the provincial government this past week, where you are right there is very friendly territory. So specifically, what is the mood like there?
Oh yeah, it's all very buoyant, positive. I mean, of course, it's a beautiful day out here, but when you take a look at the people who are around here, you know, I spoke to some folks who are strong political supporters of Doug Ford. They're here to basically have a good time, and they don't really want to talk about the negative stuff. They don't see it as a big deal. They're out to have a burger, have a little something to drink, and just be around and celebrate. One person who I spoke to specifically said that she came here because she is a strong political supporter of Doug Ford.
It just seems like I don't know anybody else that does this. It just has a nice big backyard picnic kind of thing and free, and it's just nice. So I'm very happy. There's a couple of things I wasn't, but most, by and large, I think he's just doing a great job, and I'm so glad that he's in the position he's in.
So about 15,000 people like that expected to hear at this event. We're not going to actually hear from Doug Ford until a little after 6:30. When we do, one of the things that we're going to be listening for is what does he say about how this past week has gone for him. Marivel?
All right. And you will be there watching it all for us. Thanks for this, Mike.
It was a lot of fun. It was a great season. One of my most fun seasons I've ever had. And I enjoyed it. The fans here were great.
Just over a week ago, the Toronto Raptors sent the city into a frenzy. Coming up a little later, a conversation with Raptors forward Danny Green about that championship, the fans, and a special live event that he is hosting this evening. Well, let's check in with Kim McDonald for the weather. We could see from Ford Fest, Kim, that it's a beautiful day out there today.
The weather is not controversial.
Yay.
Oh yeah, it's a beautiful weekend. What better way to start off summer? My goodness, we couldn't have asked for anything more. 24 degrees right now, lots of sunshine, the winds are light, 13 kilometers per hour coming from the northwest. So June 23rd, will be for tomorrow. What is average? So 24.8 is average. Our highest temperature, our record, 36 years ago, 32.8 degrees. We're not seeing anything like that, but I think people are going to be okay with it. So these are your evening temperatures all around the Golden Horseshoe, low 20s. I think this is pretty perfect for this time of year. And then Sunday, of course, Sunday is huge. It's the big Grand Pride Parade, and a lot of people will be outside for that. 16 degrees to start the day, 26 degrees for the afternoon. I mean, this is put on the sunscreen kind of day and make sure you reapply. I'm everybody's mother at the Pride Parade, apparently, because nobody wants to burn. And here's your temperatures and conditions throughout the day. So for Pride, 21 degrees at noon, 25 at 4 p.m., and then a really comfortable 20 degrees at 8 p.m. Just gorgeous.
Happy to put that first slather of sunscreen on, finally.
Finally.
Exactly. We'll check in with you in a bit. Thanks, Kim.
Okay, you're welcome.
Well, it has been just over a week since the Toronto Raptors made history and won the NBA championship. Fans will have another chance to show their love for the team this evening. Danny Green and some special guests will be hosting Hoop Talks and a live podcast. The Raptors forward dropped by CBC yesterday for a chat, and we started with what fans can expect from the live event this evening.
I expect a lot of fan love. Obviously, we won, so people are going to be excited. People are going to ask questions about free agency, I'm sure.
If I don't get to that first.
I'm sure they want pictures and autographs, of course. But I'm expecting to have some good topics and hopefully interact with some of the fans, have some good questions and answers, the Q&A a little bit. And, you know, we have a special guest on that. It'll be great. He's good at talking and interacting with the media and the people as well.
Okay, I'm intrigued. Can you tell us who that special guest is?
It's out there now. So Fred Van Fleet is
awesome.
Going to be aboard with us on the live pod.
Something I've noticed about you is that you aren't really that shy to interact and to engage with fans and with people. Yeah. Is that important to you?
A handful of times and get comfortable doing it, you know. But it is important to show love to those who support you, especially the real fans who are there every night when you're struggling or not. But they're behind you and they don't get a chance to actually see you. So that's why I also do my tour in Canada with the camps, letting the kids be able to interact with me in different, you know, parts of the country. Show love to those who support us all year but haven't got a chance to actually see us in person.
Those kids are going to be so excited this summer.
I hope so. Hope
to
so.
See
It'll
you.
Be a lot of fun.
So it's been a little bit over a week since you guys brought the title to Canada. Mm-hmm. How are you doing? Where are you at right now?
I'm doing okay. Finding time to get a sleep here and there when I can. But just, you know, running around getting some stuff done before, you know, we get on the road on tour. Surprisingly, I was not actually surprisingly, I might be surprised to you guys, but I probably get more sleep during the season than I do in the off season.
How is that?
I said just so much running around. During the season, we get a lot of naps. We get a lot of time before the game. We get to sleep more. In the off season, it's just nonstop here and go. I don't get many naps during the day.
So what is it about? I mean, it's clear that Toronto has really embraced you. You showed a lot of curiosity about the city when you first came. Mm-hmm. Like I saw you were like looking for cool places to eat and neighborhoods
It was a fresh start, something new, just enjoying and taking in the positive light of being in a new place. And I've come here for so many years, never got a chance to really explore as much as I wanted to, but living here gave me more opportunity to also embrace the fans and embrace the city and the communities. Of doing different things and being out in the city. So it was a lot of fun. It was a great season, one of my most fun seasons I've ever had, and I enjoyed it. The fans here were great.
So where do we go from here then? I think that's one of the things that
I hope to
so
do
many,
it again.
Yeah, I think we've
like
tasted it and now
want
more. Yeah,
I think we all
more.
Would like to go again. Yeah, like to stay on this high and not let it ever come down. So we'll see what happens. We got about a week or two before we figure out what direction things may go. So I think we're all interested and excited just as much as you guys are, the fans and the media and, you know, everybody else around the world.
Hopefully more to look forward to then.
For sure.
Okay. The parade hair, that's what I wanted to ask you
the
about.
Parade hair.
Are you still rocking that? I can't
no,
tell with the
not,
cap.
It's not, no.
Okay.
It was a wig. it was a wig and or extensions. No. I'm trying to get
it's
back
out
to normal.
It's out.
No, it's
Secret's
done.
Out.
It's done.
Yep. Well, that looked pretty cool.
Thank you.
Thanks, Danny. Yep. Appreciate it. And CBC Sports will live stream Hoop Talks, a special panel discussion with Danny Green and a host of special guests, including, as he mentioned, his teammate, Freddie Van Vliet. That begins at 6:45 on the CBC Gem streaming service and cbcsports.ca. Well, a couple of big moves in the NHL today. The Toronto Maple Leafs have shipped veteran forward Patrick Marleau to the Carolina Hurricanes for a sixth round pick next year. The Leafs have also sent a conditional first-round pick and seventh-round selection in 2022 to the Hurricanes. Now, the move helps clear cap space for Toronto by removing Marleau's $6.25 million salary. That increases the likelihood star winger Mitch Marner will stay with the Leafs. And the Nashville Predators have dealt Toronto native PK Subban to the New Jersey Devils. In return, New Jersey will give up defenseman Steven Santiani and Jeremy Davies and 2 second-round picks.
It's been almost 1 year since the devastating shooting on the Danforth, and once again, people here are coming together, coming up how a huge garage sale is helping the community fight for change.
Well, Pride Weekend is in full swing. Celebrations kicked off last night with the 10th annual Trans March. They continue today with the Dyke March. The march took off from Church and Hayden Streets. Thousands of people taking part, marching down Yonge all the way to Allen Gardens. Hundreds more lined the route, cheering on the participants. This is the 23rd year for the march, and though organizers don't have exact numbers, they say that it is safe to say this is the largest dyke march yet. They say as well, like the trans march yesterday, it's an event that just keeps getting bigger and bigger every year. We spoke to some of the participants during the march.
Want to make sure they understand that inclusivity counts and there's different types of families, and it's just proud to be who you are.
Happy Pride! Happy Pride! Happy Pride!
It feels amazing. I feel like it's okay to be who you are.
I personally really appreciate the fight that the Stonewall riots had to basically fight against, and it's just so important to kind of come back to your roots and realize that as much as we want to celebrate and as much as it is a celebration of love and being yourself, it is also a celebration of those who sacrificed so much before us.
Love is love. Thank you.
We are approaching the one-year anniversary of the devastating shooting on the Danforth. The milestone pushed many in Riverdale to come together today and host a massive community sale. Most of the proceeds will go towards a charity chosen by the victims' families. Taylor Simmons was there too.
I'm selling lots of stuff.
Clothes, toys, and books galore around the Riverdale neighborhood today, with each resident doing their part.
Have you been selling lots of lemonade?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes? How much?
Lots.
65 families hosted sales outside their homes. Tilly Gray organized the event to bring people together ahead of a tragic milestone. 1 month today will mark 1 year since a shooter took two young lives and injured 13 more. Yesterday, police said after an 11-month-long investigation, they still don't know why it happened.
All of us needed to come together to do something, to the extent that one can ease into an anniversary like this.
Residents and shoppers alike agreed it just feels good to talk to each other.
Everyone always hangs out at the square down the street, and that was something that just shattered that. And this is a good way to sort of say we're all still coming together, and let's put all our efforts towards a good cause.
Organizers say before everything got going today, vendors had committed to donating at least 30% of their proceeds to the Coalition for Gun Control. But speaking to people here today, they say they're donating way more than that.
We're planning to give half.
I would pretty much say it's going to be all of the money.
The families of the victims chose the charity, which is working towards banning handguns.
You know, I think every gun that's off the streets is a good thing.
When it hits so close to home, you can't help but really realize that it's a big problem.
Tilly says she hopes the sale will become a yearly tradition with even more participants.
We certainly don't want to have people suffering in isolation if they're feeling anxious about the anniversary as I was.
For now, neighbors are coping the best way they know how, by leaning on each other. Taylor Simmons, CBC News, Toronto.
A large crowd came out to remember a Regent Park mom killed on Thursday. Ismathara Ratna was struck by a vehicle while crossing the street. She leaves behind a husband and three young children. A memorial now stands at the intersection of Regent Park Boulevard and Dundas Street East. That's where she was struck by a car that mounted the curb she was standing on. A 40-year-old man, Joshua Smoke, is charged with impaired driving causing death. Ratna's family says she was going to visit a friend when she was killed. The body of a Canadian soldier who died in a parachute exercise in Bulgaria is being returned to Canada tonight. Bombardier Patrick Labrie died after something went wrong in a training jump from a low altitude Monday night. The Department of National Defense says his body will arrive at the Ottawa airport at 8 o'clock tonight. The military continues to investigate Labrie's death. Dozens of people in Hamilton came out to counter-protest yellow vest demonstrations outside City Hall after a physical confrontation broke out at the Hamilton Pride Festival last weekend. Residents say hate has no place in Hamilton.
Here today to support the diversity in our city and for all of us to stand up against hatred, bigotry, and xenophobia.
With the violence at the Pride Festival last weekend in Hamilton, I don't condone violence on either side. I think we all need to live together peacefully in this beautiful city that we call home.
Many have criticized the city for allowing the yellow vests to demonstrate on city property every Saturday. The yellow vest movement started in Europe over rising fuel prices, but has expanded to North America to include the far right. Investigators in Hamilton have suggested, but not confirmed, that people from the yellow vest movement may have been involved in last weekend's incident. Live shot of the harbor front for you. Summer off to a good start in Toronto. Will these temperatures stick around for the rest of Pride weekend? We'll have another look at the weather forecast after the break. As part of CBC News' climate change series In Our Backyard, our producers went to the movies, specifically documentaries about climate change. Al Gore's An Inconvenient Truth won accolades, but harder to gauge is whether such docs spur viewers into action. Deanna Sumanak-Johnson has the story, and a warning, some viewers may find an animal scene in this story disturbing.
The breakaway of an iceberg the size of a skyscraper.
You know that rich voice.
They need to get really close. before making their final sprint.
It usually tells us tales of Earth's magnificence. Now David Attenborough is talking about that beauty in grave danger.
Glaciers have always released ice into the ocean. But now this is happening nearly twice as fast as it did 10 years ago.
We knew that wildlife films, big landmark wildlife films, can reach a lot of people. But they don't often actually move the dial in terms of changing people's views and habits towards the natural world. And we wanted to try and create a series that would do just that.
In an effort to reach more people, and especially younger viewers, the producers of Our Planet released it on Netflix. They felt strongly about including this disturbing scene, walruses falling off a cliff because their natural environment, sea ice, melted away.
What we knew as soon as we saw that this was probably going to be the footage that would become most associated with the climate change horror that's happening to Arctic species. So it was very, very important footage.
You see everything decimated. I mean, it looks like a dead zone here.
Generally, just how much documentaries spur human action on climate change is difficult to gauge. 73 people from around the U.S. were asked to watch the series Years of Living Dangerously in a recent small study from George Washington University. Afterwards, they were asked how they felt about climate change. The study found people who primarily experienced sadness, hopelessness, depressive feelings, or apathy were less likely to want to act. After years of working at the National Geographic Channel as a producer, Maggie Stogner now runs the Center for Environmental Filmmaking at American University. She steers her students away from doom and gloom documentaries and also those that seem preachy or patronizing.
It doesn't work that way. You lure people in through entertainment. Through
also on her do list, believe it or not, humor.
It gets people to listen who might go, climate change, roll my eyes again. Not going to listen to anything more about climate change. And then there's a little comedy moment and they go, wait a minute, I'll look at that. Wait, a comedy? Wait, okay, let me see.
Are we gonna die?
You know what, Bieber? We might die. I'm not gonna lie to you. I mean, there's so many people out there who don't think global warming's a real thing. You know, we gotta save this planet. We're being stupid.
All in an effort to help forge a new generation of environmental filmmakers with a lofty ambition to tell a story that can change hearts and minds and maybe even save the planet. Deanna Sumanak-Johnson, CBC News, Washington.
Checking in with Kim again for the long-range forecast. Hopefully, if this weekend's any indicator, it's going to be a really nice week.
You know, I'm only filling in, so I can say we've got a whole summer of beautiful weather, Maribel.
And then,
see you in September.
Gone. Yeah.
Well, we have a beautiful day on Sunday. We had a gorgeous day on Saturday. You are welcome. I take flack when it's not nice, so I'm just going to take that because it is nice. So there's the Toronto Pride Parade. Forecast couldn't be more beautiful. We've got a ridge of high pressure in place. We see a low pressure system to our west, but it is slow going because that high pressure is well in place, which is great. That's what we want. That is eventually going to move in, though. So we don't have sun all week long, but it's not going to be a bad week. So here we go into Sunday, temperatures around 26 degrees for daytime highs, but that ridge is going to start to break down, allowing for this rain to come in on Monday, and there is the threat of thunderstorms on Monday as well. This is going to wrap up by Tuesday morning, and then by Tuesday afternoon, we're looking at things clearing out nicely. We're also looking at that warmth. So here comes the warm front. Temperatures are on the rise this week. In fact, we will start to feel Humidex readings near 30. We haven't had that yet this year, so that will be nice. It really is going to start to feel like summer. So Toronto, rain showers wrapping up on Tuesday morning and then coming back again Wednesday evening. But look at these temperatures. We've got high 20s, feeling like the low 30s and a perfect weekend to start off summer.
The Humidex, that might be welcome for once. Thanks,
bring it
Kim.
On.
Yeah, thank
You're
you.
You're welcome.
Well, the beautiful weather and Pride celebrations, too good to resist for one couple. We're going to introduce you to Graham and Rob, who tied the knot today.
It's phenomenal. Like growing up in, you know, a time where gay marriage wasn't legal, to be able to celebrate this at Pride with my partner and with our family, it means the world to us.
RuPaul's Drag Race star Shangela hosted the ceremony for the lucky couple today. They posed for pictures and took a big bite out of that rainbow-colored cake. The newlyweds met 7 years ago online after Graham reached out to everyone on his Facebook list to vote for him in a costume contest on Church Street. Graham won that, by the way. Well, congratulations to the happy couple. And that is our show for you tonight. Thank you for watching. You can stay caught up on news anytime on our website, cbcnews.ca. Have a great night, everyone.